Brought to you by Penguin.
All Dogs Great and Small, written and read by Graeme Hall. For excellent Gordon, without whom none of this would have happened. This book is a work of non-fiction based on the life, experiences and recollections of the author. In some cases, names of people, places, dates, sequences and the detail of events have been changed to protect the privacy of others. Foreword by Julian Norton. I had a busy morning on the farm, pregnancy testing cows, with my arm in the place where most farm vets put them if we don't know what else to do. As we worked our way through the herd, Eric, the farmer, related a strange problem about his adolescent Springer Spaniel. It was a problem the likes of which I'd never come across before. He explained the situation, I think looking for a solution. My new dog has a strange problem. I don't know what to do, and it's getting rather embarrassing. Every time the telephone rings, he ejaculates all over the kitchen floor. Any ideas what might be going on in his head? What do you think I can do? Is it normal, is it? Have you heard of this sort of thing before? He emphasised one word with unnecessary vigour. After I pulled my arm out of the cow and picked myself up off the floor, having collapsed with laughter, I regained my composure and a small degree of professionalism. Well, Eric, I've never heard of that before, I confessed, between chortles. Eric was not amused, because it was getting to become quite a messy problem, as well as an embarrassing one. Maybe you should change your ringtone, was the only advice I could give. As vets, we often see dogs, and sometimes cats, rabbits and ferrets, with behavioural issues. Some are funny, like Eric's spaniel, and some are more serious, causing anxiety to the canine and concern to the owner. Many of these problems are deep-seated and complicated, and not easily investigated by x-rays or blood tests, harder to cure than a deep-seated skin infection or a disease of the prostate gland. Even a broken bone or a torn ligament has the chance of a once-only surgical repair. We must remember that dogs are both pets, fully assimilated into the family of humans and an integral part of the pack, but also reasonably primitive beings, not a million miles away from a wolf. My first dog, Paddy the Border Terrier, who was cuter than any dog I've enjoyed the company of, quickly reverted to his inner wolf when he got the smell of a deer or hare. He was fired by adrenaline, but even with this and powered by the red mist, his little legs stood no chance of ever catching his quarry. So the job of adjusting, balancing and juggling the complicated canine brain, which strives to advance itself to match the rest of the pack on the one hand, and yet is obsessed by pheromones and anal scents on the other, is beset on both sides by conflicting inequities. I do not envy the challenges that Graeme is faced with every day. I felt privileged to have been asked to write this foreword. Graeme and I have a lot in common. We're both from Yorkshire. We both have found an unlikely home on Channel 5, a home where we can both share our love and work for anyone who cares to watch. We both earn our living by working with animals, which is a privilege in itself. The circumstances of our first meeting and how we came to talk about me doing the foreword of this book were unusual. In London, at Television Centre Wood Lane, one damp day in February, we met outside the green room. I'd just appeared with Holly and Phil on This Morning to promote my most recent book, A Yorkshire Vet, The Next Chapter, the fifth in a line, which represented my latest obsession. Graeme had been promoting the new series of his popular show. I think his animals were quite well behaved on set. Well, they would, I suppose. Mine had not. Peter the alpaca had taken instant dislike to the presenters. Holly panicked and hid behind the sofa, as she's prone to doing, and Philip received a face full of alpaca spit. Luckily, the arrival of a vet who's familiar with the curious camelids quickly restored order. After our respective scintillating appearances on the award-winning daytime show, we were both buzzing with the after-effects of adrenaline and chatted in front of the big screen where publicity photos are taken. Generally, this is the place for taking Instagram snaps, but we both found it hilarious and ridiculous in equal measure. At one point, Lorraine Kelly walked past on her way to presenting her own award-winning show and said good morning to both of us, just as if we were both best friends and it was all completely normal to meet Graeme and Julian on a Thursday morning outside the green room. I've been in a few green rooms over recent years, and when talking about them, I always feel compelled to explain that they're not green at all. They're just like normal rooms. There's nothing green or special about them. But that's fine, because there's no reason why these rooms would be special, because in fact they're not filled with megastars or divas. Most of the time they're filled with normal people, doing pretty normal things, who just happen to be on telly. Like Graeme and me. Normal people, doing normal things, but with interesting creatures as our subjects. This book explores a career working with amazing animals, and it's an insight into Graeme's unlikely insertion into the world of telly. It's an interesting read and a journey with which I can entirely empathise. I hope you enjoy it. Julian Norton, vet, Yorkshire vet, author of vet books. Introduction. If 15 years ago you told me I'd be sitting down to begin writing a book about dogs, I'd have laughed. What I knew about dogs could have been written on the back of a postage stamp. After all, I was 40 before I even had a dog of my own. It wasn't for the lack of wanting. As a boy, I and my younger sister Andrea often asked our parents if we could have a pet. My mum and dad maintained it wouldn't be fair because we wouldn't be home enough. But there was something my dad used to say, which I realise now, after he's gone, had great significance. It's too upsetting when they go. When I was older, he told me a story from his childhood that explained perfectly why he felt this way. I've included it later because this is a book of stories, the stories of dogs I've met and the people who love them. I'll begin with my own. I grew up dogless in a market town in North Yorkshire called Selby. It was all right, which is Yorkshire speak for very good indeed. I had a great childhood. My dad was an electrician in the sugar factory. My mum was a swimming teacher at the local swimming baths, as was her mother before her. Later, I passed my 11 plus exam by the skin of my teeth, and I went off to school in Leeds by train. It was a huge, great metropolis. It seemed to 11-year-old me that nobody in Selby had ever been further than Leeds or York. The first dog I remember was a miniature apricot-coloured poodle called Pepe. He moved into a bungalow opposite where we lived. He was a sweet thing, and we'd ride our bikes around, and he'd always be there. Now, funnily enough, the first dog I ever lived with was also a poodle. This one was called Noodle, and he belonged to my pretend daughter, April. I've never liked the word step when it comes to parenting, as in stepdaughter. It seems to always to go alongside wicked. Anyway, I met April's mum. Noodle the poodle was already a firm fixture, and he and I got along just fine. In the years that followed, I came to know a couple of Rottweilers who are big, lovable lumps. There's something very reassuring about a solid dog, and I figured that if I was going to get a dog, I might as well go for the full fat option. And so a Rottweiler puppy called Axel entered my life. My first dog from scratch. Not being one to do things by half, I got another one 9 months later. There's something magical about having a dog from puppyhood. We went to visit the breeder 3 times before we picked Axel. The first time when he was just 3 weeks old. Later, when he was a great big 50 kilo power pack of a boy, it amused me to tell people that there was a time I could hold him in one hand. Having a puppy taught me that you've got to do things again and again and again. Because you teach them little things like sit or down and you think they've got it, you might be inclined to assume, great, that's that then. No, it's not, because tomorrow it seems as if they've forgotten and you have to tell them again. You've got to have patience, and that's not something that came naturally to me. I was working for Weetabix in Northamptonshire when I got Axel. I was an operations manager, so I ran factories for a living. I came to it in an odd way via a Hispanic Studies degree from the University of Hull. Weetabix was a long way from languages, and dogs were a long way from Weetabix. When I got the job in my final year at uni, and I announced it to my housemates, they all fell about laughing. They thought it was a joke, because my diet mostly involved Weetabix for breakfast, lunch, and tea. I worked for the company for 21 years, starting off as a graduate trainee, and then as a supervisor of about 8 people, making Alpen in a little factory in Corby. I worked my way up from there, and by the time I left, I was reporting to a company director and had about 200 people in my team. It was Axel that got me into dog training. I'd already started to do the best job I possibly could with him because I always believed that if a job's worth doing, it's worth doing well. So this was my first time with a puppy, and it was a pretty serious breed. Back in those days, in the early 2000s, Rottweilers were very much the media's designated evil breed. The tabloid press just loved to show pictures of them baring their teeth. Whenever there was a dog attack, often involving completely different breeds, they'd roll out a stock picture of a Rottweiler and caption it with a cliché of devil dog. I was determined to be a responsible dog owner. I was also a serving special police officer at the time, so I wanted to do the right thing and train Axel properly. I threw myself into learning as much as I possibly could. Then 9 months later, Gordon, the second Rottweiler, came along. And now I had not one, but 2 of these great big dogs. It was a serious proposition. I got involved in something called Schutzhund. It's German for protection dog. In Germany, it's a tradition to train German shepherd dogs, but also other breeds, in the manner of police dogs, but only for trials and competitions. It's a civilian thing, and the dogs are trained in obedience, in the way you see at Cross, as well as jumping over hurdles and up and down A-frames. Plus, they're trained in tracking ascent on the ground and protection work. In learning about Schutzhund, I was learning about dog aggression and how to control it. If you can learn the triggers that make a dog aggressive on command, as the police do, and you also know how to avoid it as well, you know how to turn it off. The head trainer took me under his wing, and every Sunday I spent every minute I could watching dog after dog come onto the training field. The trainer taking control and showing what to do, me trying to work out why on earth he'd done something different to the last dog. I left Weetabix and I was set on being a management consultant. I took 3 months off, and in this time I threw myself into the dog training. Towards the end, I told the head trainer I was off to be a management consultant. "Why don't you be a dog trainer?" he asked. "Why do you think I should do that?" And then he said something that changed the course of my life. "Because you're good with people." "Okay," I said, a bit surprised. "What about dogs then?" No, he said, "you're good with dogs. But there are lots of people who are good with dogs. You've got the dog thing and the people thing. You can do both. And there's not many out there like that. So I think you'd be very good at it. I think you should consider it." I jumped into my Land Rover and I used the drive from Birmingham to Northampton to consider my future. And when you drive a Defender along the slow lane of the M6, you got plenty of time to think. By the time I got home, I'd made up my mind. I was going to be a dog trainer. I came up with a company name, The Dogfather, and I put an ad in the local paper, the Northampton Chronicle and Echo, the size of a postage stamp, and patiently waited by the phone. Nothing happened. I repeated the exercise the next week, and the one after that. And about a week later, at 8 p.m, the phone rang. It was a mobile number I didn't recognise. This was it. "Is that the dog trainer?" "Yeah," I replied, because that's what I was from that moment on. When I went out to see the person who'd rung me a couple of days later, it was a dark November's night in Northampton's Eastern District. We walked around as the dog pulled on the lead and we stopped under street lamps so I could explain things. I'd gone from a warm factory to a freezing cold pavement, and it was hard work, but I was doing something that I was growing to love. Some advice I was given from someone I really respected before I started was that it's not the letters after your name that matter most, it's the number of dogs that have been through your hands. And this was dog number one. There was a long road ahead. The business built slowly. Initially, I didn't charge much, about 40 quid for a couple of hours training. By the following March, I was holding Kennel Club listed puppy and adult dog classes. I'd see more than 20 dogs over 3 hours in an evening, and if ever there was a hands-on intensive course in dog and owner behaviour, this was it. The business grew, and I built a reputation locally and further afield. Within 3 years, I was working everywhere, from Scotland to the south coast of England. During those years, when I'd done a really good job, I'd say jokingly, "I should be on the telly, mate." I never thought for one moment it would happen, and I never did anything to make it happen. And then one day, in 2016, 8 years after I began, and totally out of the blue, the phone rang, like so many times before. And the caller said, "Is that the dog trainer?" But this was a different call altogether. It was a life-changing moment. The woman on the end of the phone was from a TV production company, looking for a dog trainer to feature in a new show. The premise was that they wanted to follow me around the country, helping dogs and their owners with problem behaviours. That's dog behaviour and owner behaviour. From early on, I was determined I wanted to be involved only if it was a show where I could help owners and give useful tips and tricks of the trade, but also reflect how much fun dogs are. I didn't think it would go anywhere, but I happily went off to meet them. And the more they talked about it, the more interesting the idea became. To cut a very long story short, we made a pilot which aired on Channel 4 before the show was eventually commissioned by Channel 5. As I write, we've just begun filming Series 3 of Dogs Behaving Very Badly after the 2020 lockdown. It's great to be out there again with the crew and, of course, meeting dog owners and their badly behaved pets. It's a great show and I love working on it because it gives me the opportunity to help loads of people in one go. When I do a private one-to-one consultation, it's me and whoever is at home. On TV, I can talk to more than a million people at a time and many more on catch-up too. People often get in touch with the programme to say that they've been following some advice given in the show and that it's helped to fix their dog. It makes me happy and proud when that happens. One of the most fun episodes was a celebrity special we filmed as part of Channel 5's Animal Charity Week. I got to work with Denise Van Outen and her gorgeous, if spoiled, French bulldog Tilly, Michael Owen and his overly protective Staffordshire Bull Terrier Ronnie, and opera singer Russell Watson and his nervous Saluki Poppy. It was lovely to meet household names. On stage or on the pitch, they're special, but at home, they're real people with real dog problems, and it was a pleasure to help out. I see this book as an extension of that. It's a mixture of stories, a few of which dogs behaving very badly.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.